I would like to offer several units of thanks to Squarespace for sponsoring today's video. Hello and welcome to the Grand Line Review, your source for everything One Piece. My name is Liam, and I'm just gonna go ahead and say it. I don't like mushrooms. And today we are here to discuss the imminent future of One Piece. Because post Wano, this world is going to look very, very different. Old faces will fall, new faces will rise, and there may even be some cursed face swapping. It's very difficult to predict what will happen when two emperors fall, so anything's possible, I suppose. However, there are two broad options. One is that the construct of the four emperors will collapse entirely, and two is that the simultaneous defeat of dose emperors will result in a grand power vacuum ready to be filled by new emperors. And that latter option is what we're going to be exploring here today. The characters who have the potential to fill these gaps and make the world government go, oh no, this is a bad thing. But it's all going to commence with a quick round of the Faux Emperors, a very simple minigame, the rules of which are as follows. Here we find ourselves with our four emperors. However, one of them is actually Bon Clay in sneaky disguise. And your task is going to be to guess which of these emperors is the imposter. Now, should you guess incorrectly, then your punishment will be to subscribe to the Grand Line Review, thus resulting in consistent injections of One Piece culture administered directly into your YouTube feed. And if you are correct, then Bon Clay will proceed to steal your identity and start living your life just slightly more flamboyantly. So we have some pretty high stakes here today. But which emperor will it be? Red hair, pink hair, black hair, or no teeth? Make your selection now and we shall reveal the answer in 3, 2, 1, and bam, it was Big Mom. Probably because Bon Clay approves of her pink color scheme. But if you chose incorrectly, then you know the thing to do, and please do say hi in the comments below if you are a new member of the Grand Fleet. Welcome. So let's now directly address the Emperor system, and yes, it is a system. Through whatever means, the New World has found itself having organically developed four factions of leadership, each one preventing the other three from getting out of hand, or each three preventing one from getting out of hand, whichever way you prefer to look at it. It's basically the equivalent of four people holding guns at each other's heads, but it does seem to work. It provides very precarious stability, which yes, I know is an oxymoron, but did you know that you are also an oxymoron? Yeah, you think about that. But the greater aspect of balance is that for the most part, the Emperor system actively prevents new major powers from rising, because that would be like trying to break into the online selling market and directly competing against four Amazons. There is no way you're getting into that. However, if two of those companies were to instantly cease to exist, then that would leave a big old gap in the marketplace. In this case, that marketplace would be filthy. Filthy piracy. So let's get into what kind of finely shaped people can fill this gap, commencing with, of course, one Monkey D. Luffy. Technically already considered an emperor, or at least a power alongside the emperors, he's pretty perfectly poised to inherit one of these positions, whether he likes it or not. In terms of pure criteria, Luffy ticks every box, possessing blunt political influence with nations such as Alabasta, Water 7, the Goa Kingdom, Dressrosa, Fishman Island, and soon to be Wano. At this point, Luffy may as well indirectly own about half the world, but alongside this, he also has a non-consensual grand fleet backing him up, consisting of 5,640 members. Plus, Luffy does also have his own core crew with several marvelous commander candidates and even a former warlord of the sea. And this is the sort of thing that we will be looking for going forward. The most important thing for an emperor to possess is influence. So that automatically kicks out characters like Mihawk, Weevil, Weehawk, and Meevil. All of them are strong, but they don't have that influential X factor, especially Meevil. Whereas I would describe Luffy is a sort of furious drain. He just sucks up anyone and everything around him. A more powerful and certainly a more metaphorical black hole than Teach could ever hope to conjure. Zeha, mate. However, Luffy is not the only character capable of producing this effect, and our next emperor candidate is going to be Buggy the Clown. And I want to emphasize that yes, this is a serious pick. The meme culture around Buggy can admittedly get a bit iffy at times, but his capacity to just fail all of the way upwards would put even Australian politicians to shame. But the thing about Buggy is that he is undeniably, incidentally charismatic. This clown man has fate on his side, and when I say fate, I mean Oda. Oda absolutely loves Buggy, and that meta reasoning alone is enough for me to see him continuing to snowball into further power. I mean, just cast your minds back to the Alabasta saga. Now imagine that someone time traveled back to where you were at that point and provided you with the spoiler that Buggy would become a warlord of the sea. You would dismiss the idea entirely. You would probably call the time traveler a liar and a charlatan, and even question the practical validity of time travel as a concept. But as the years went on, as it turns out, Buggy did become a warlord, and you became a clown. You know, a bit of a twist of irony there. And also from an in-world perspective, Buggy is a natural gathering point for a lot of, how shall we say, loose pirates. He has an impressive pedigree of having sailed with Goldie Roger. He is a genuine contemporary of Redhead Shanks, and during the Paramount War, he actively fought against combatants such as Dracul Mihawk. To those who don't have the advantage of narrative context, Buggy is a figure to be feared and respected. Of course, to us, he's a figure to mock and or laugh at, and that pure comedy is exactly why I would love to see Buggy accidentally stumble his way into becoming an Emperor of the Sea. Though I guess I should probably address that there is a slight problem currently, in that the Marines are out to capture him. But just picture this potential hilarity. The Marines are successful in capturing every member of the Warlords except for Buggy. His notoriety would explode yet again, and he would be very well positioned to stick his clown nose into the conveniently clown nose shaped power vacuum. One option though would be to plug this vacuum before it gets too out of hand, and there is at least one candidate who can potentially pull this off, being Charlotte Katakuri. In the event that Big Mom is removed from her bigliness, this is who the Charlotte family would rally around, primarily because he is actually liked and respected by them, as opposed to feared. Alright, are you ready? Here is my best Katakuri impression. So the Katakuri potential would almost act as a transfer of power, in a similar manner to which Marco assumed the leadership of the Whitebeard Pirates following the death of Daddy Newgate. Although the issue with the Katakuri idea is that unlike Luffy and Buggy, Katakuri ascending to emperorship would be more akin to attempting to repair some sort of crumbling skyscraper. It would be an extraordinarily difficult task due to the overwhelming sense of despair. A failing empire versus established and rising empires is never the greatest of situations to be in. I suppose Katakuri isn't the only leadership candidate, though. We also know that Perospero has his sights set on becoming an emperor. But even though he may look like a clown, I think that we all know that he does not possess the key qualities of our one and only bug clown. I suppose there's also Caesar clown, so that's two clowns, but we are not adding a third, so just go away, Perospero. Good play over there. Amongst all of this new emperor talk, the name Eustace Kidd also tends to come up quite a bit. But our main problem here is that the emperors already have a redhead with a missing arm. So it becomes very difficult to see Junkyard Shanks standing alongside actual Shanks, and it really is all just a bit redundant, isn't it? However, the biggest issue is that nobody actually follows Eustace Kidd, just Killer and the Kid Pirates, whose names nobody knows. I mean, off the top of my head, you have BDSM Zombie Man and BDSM Chackle Man. You know, starting to realize why there are so many Kid fanfics now. I wish I hadn't. So maybe Kidd could convince some of the Impel Down guards to follow some of his king cult, but he simply does not have the influence required to fill an emperor position. And the same goes for Trafalgar Law, and in fact any of the remaining Worst Generation members. The best situation I could see happening is that the entire Worst Generation, not including Blackbeard, together create something of an informal glob of small powers that together could rival the forces of any given emperor. One interesting candidate, however, may be Marco. Now I featured him before in a video entitled The Lost Emperors of One Piece, because Marco is quite possibly the closest any individual has come to emperorhood, only to fail to fully grasp that status. Here in Sydney, we have something of a colloquial term known as getting off at Redfern. Redfern being the stop right before Central. And it's used to describe the act of, pulling out. That's what Marco did with his chances of becoming an emperor. He got off at Redfern. I guess more accurately, Blackbeard forced him off the train. Metaphor kind of falls apart there, doesn't it? But the fact remains that he is Marco the Phoenix, and he is the natural leader of what remains of the Whitebeard Pirates and all of their ally things. Because in an exceptional situation, they would certainly rally behind him once more, particularly because the crew family bond goes beyond anything we've seen in the crews of other emperors. That kind of loyalty will never die, so once again, under the right circumstances, Marco has full command of an army worthy of an emperor. The only question is, would he lead a force like that himself, or would he defer command to Luffy? Who in turn would be all like, "Yo, your army is cramping my style, Birdman." So just like his Phoenix namesake, Marco could rise from his own ashes to become a global superpower yet again, even if he is set on having those forces align with Luffy. And speaking of Phoenixes, here is the number one rated Phoenix joke on UpJoke. What do you get when you touch Phoenix? Bird degree burns. That was the number one Phoenix joke on UpJoke, and as a society, I think we can do better, maybe. So leave your Phoenix joke in the comments below, if you have one. If you don't, don't know, leave something. One question that does also come to mind amongst all of this is what happens to the Beast Pirates? When the Whitebeard Pirates dissolved, they had Marco to fall back on, and the Big Mom Pirates would theoretically have Katakuri, maybe Perospero at worst. But that natural second in command doesn't necessarily exist within the Beast Pirates because their primary ruling mechanism is fear. Queen, for example, would never be able to inspire a large following as anything other than a global pop star, that is. He really did miss his calling by going into this whole cyborg dinosaur business. As for Jack, well, he's a well-documented scrub. So I guess that leaves King, who I don't think anyone has any strong opinions on whatsoever. If I were to ask you to give me King's defining personality trait, then what would you tell me? Because I would say that I think that his main goal is to rid himself of any personality whatsoever. He's powerful and he's loyal, but there is very little else of substance to King. And when there's no substance, there's no nothing, and that nothing is not good enough to rally the remnants of the Beast Pirates around him. So I'm quite curious to see what will become of this 20,000 member crew. I mean, maybe they'll start following Tama. Maybe Tama is the next emperor. I'm not ruling it out. That about does it for pirates who have the potential to fill this gap. However, there is another organization in existence that satisfies all of the relevant criteria without being pirates. And that is, of course, the Revolutionary Army. They have a charismatic nose-picking leader in Dragon, an ever-expanding influence on the world, and a literal army filled with ferociously powerful individuals. They also have a koala, and as an Australian, I like that. I like that a lot. They're very much the sleeping giant of One Piece, though, and getting rid of two emperors of the sea may actually leave room for the Revolutionary Army to emerge as a third competing faction, alongside filthy pirates and slightly physically cleaner but morally filthier agents of the world government. So I'm not saying that Dragon will become recognized as an emperor of the sea, but more that he would spawn and restore balance for the remaining powers. However, the option I'm betting on most is that after Wano, the entire concept of emperors of the sea will become irrelevant. When you have a whole power structure referred to as the four emperors, things become just a little bit sad when only two of those four remain. Plus, it would be quite thematically appropriate given that right now the world government has ceased the Seven Warlords program, so it just feels right to have all of the established constructs of power crumble and for our new generation to take their place, to reform the world in their own image or something epic and storytellish like that. At that point, the only thing remaining would be the world government, but once that falls, that would be the final major pillar of One Piece vanquished, thus leaving us with a new and exciting world full of possibilities. I mean, who knows, it might even bring an end to the era of piracy altogether, because without the tyranny of the world government, would there be any need for it? And if all else fails, then I think we should take Miguel Vale's suggestion that the emperor system is awful and should be switched by the metric system. And as a proud metric system user, I agree. And I'll also agree to thank Squarespace for sponsoring today's video, because that was a nice thing to do. Squarespace gives you a powerful and versatile platform to craft not only your own website, but also your own community. It does this through a combination of powerful blogging tools, Squarespace extensions, and displaying posts from your social profiles. Connect with your audience and generate revenue through gated members-only content. Manage your members, send email communications, and leverage audience insights, all on one easy-to-use platform. Go to squarespace.com for a free trial, and when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/groundlinereview to save 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain. And then after that, go and grab yourself some more One Piece from this here video. There's always more to learn, explore, and experience about this wonderful series, so I look forward to seeing you there.